Hi, I'm so sorry. I was caught off with something else, and then I don't know if you just saw, but my system crashed just like a minute ago, so I just rebooted. It's just not a good day, but we will let's get started. Can y'all hear me? Yeah, all right, cool. I'm so sorry for the delay. So let's get started, and I hope my system doesn't crash again. All right. Okay, so today's session is gonna be more hands-on than usual, right? Can't hear anything. Let me see. That on my end. Okay, I didn't change anything, so here are the slides, but honestly there isn't much in the slides. Because it's mostly just a bunch of introductions to different parts of Git, and then a bunch of exercises that will get you to use that functionality in Git. So you can kind of do without the slides even, but that's a link to the slides if you want them. So I have to assume you will have to have a command line Git in order to follow along. And I will kind of assume that you have experience with like with using command line Git. As well as basic Git knowledge, right? So like how to create commits, create branches, what else? Yeah, switch branches and so on, like the at least the basic things, right? So that is sort of assumed. And one of the outcomes of today is that hope to get you sort of comfortable with reading the Git manual pages. In order to figure things out, because if you want to, that is the source of information, as if you want to know about all the final options, like all the uncommon options, all the internals about Git, right? Git is pretty well documented. So the link of the slides are here. So let's get started. Yes. So let's just dive straight into Git mechanics, right? So if you attend my Git introduction workshop, I normally say that Git is a snapshot based repository, right? What that means is that how Git works is to take a snapshot of your entire repository every time you create a commit. And as opposed to being a patch-based system whereby you compare the differences and you store the patches between, or you store the differences, right? So Git does not do that. Git actually stores your entire like stores the actual so every time you create a commit, you just store the entire repository, and the differences are actually calculated on the fly when you want to do when you look at a diff or something like that. Git calculates the diff on the fly, right? So it doesn't store the diff, it stores the actual commits, right? So this Git is a snapshot based version control system. Then how does Git actually store the data, right? So we'll go into more detail of about the Git on this format at the end. But ultimately, so at the start, let's just go through the high level idea of how Git stores the actually represents its objects, right? So at a high level, a Git repository is just a bunch of objects, right? And these objects have a SHA SHA-1 hash, right? Based on your contents. So a Git repository is just a bunch of objects, and these have a SHA-1 hash. Yeah, so an object is either a commit or a commit, right? The object itself represents a commit, right? Or it represents a tree or a blob, right? What is a tree? A tree is basically a list of blobs or trees. So basically they represent the directory. And then the blob just represents a file. So a commit has a tree, right? That represents the contents of the commit. And then the tree can contain files which will be based on the whatever files you have in that commit. And each commit has a parent commit, right? And then some metadata. So that means that each commit is a snapshot of files. As we have said, right? And then there are some associated metadata, which is the time of the commit, the author, the committer, the message, so on. And then each commit points to a number of parent commits. Okay. So if you look at this, let me blank out first. So that means each commit, we have a commit object. Commit object has a tree, so it points to a tree, and a tree points to a file, so like let's say file 1, and then it points to a blob, and then contents of the blob, and then a commit has a parent. It should have a parent. The only commits that do not have parents are the first commits, like in a repository or a branch, right? That's the only commits that don't have parents. So each commit will have a parent. And every commit will point to a tree. So this tree will be a separate tree, right? Of its own. And then this commit will have its own parent, or maybe no parent, right? Depending on if this is the first commit or not. And then each of these commits will have a message. And other metadata, right? So, and then you can have more commits. And so then, so then you create a chain of commits, right? So this is the latest commit, and this is the parent commit, and this is the parent commit, right? And then you can have a commit that has multiple parents, right? And that is what we call a merge commit, because they bring together two branches. They bring together two branches sort of join them together, right? And so the merge commit has two or more parents. But in terms of the contents, it doesn't really like a merge commit. Ultimately, it's just a normal commit. It still has a tree that represents the contents at the time of the commit, right? It's just that we track two parents. So logically, you can say that the changes or the contents of this commit came from both parents, right? What those changes are sort of, when you ask Git for the diff, then you can say, okay, you want a diff from this parent or this parent, you know, that kind of thing. Because it's calculated when you actually ask for the diff, right? Because again, Git just stores the contents of the of the actual file contents rather than patches or changes. Okay, so now, the way that these references are done, right, is actually by the SHA hash. So that means that the commit, this commit will have a parent, and then it will specify the parent, the SHA-1 hash of its parent, right? And then here, it will specify the SHA-1 hash of its parent. of let's say commit, name is 1, 2, and 3. So this SHA-1 of 2 and this SHA-1 of 1, right? And then this one maybe no parent lah. And then over here as well, the way that this is specified is of course the SHA-1 of this tree, right? So this actually equals to SHA-1 of 3-1. Right. And yeah. So if you were to go and to look if you go to look at let me pull up a Git repository. If you were to look at the Git repository, right? You see this hash. This is the hash of the commit object, right? This is the hash of the commit object, and then if you click on this, you see the commit object. It will show you the parent commit hash, right? This is the hash of the commit, right? And okay, GitHub doesn't show you the tree hash, but you can look at the browse files. Yeah, so GitHub only shows you the hash of the the commit object, right? But if you wanted, later on we can look at the hash of the we can look at the hash of the tree as well as the blobs. Okay. So back to this. Back to this. Does this seem familiar to anyone? Does this seem like something else that some other technology that is very common nowadays? Yes, blockchain. Yes. But you should notice that Git, this was invented, this was created in like 2005 or 2004, right? Before we had all the blockchain was actually popular, so Git came first, right? And if you're using Git, you're using a blockchain. It is literally a blockchain, right? This is a block, and then you have it refers to the parent block, right, by the hash, and refers to the parent block by the hash as well, and so on, right? And then each block refers to its contents by the hash of the contents, right? Just like the blockchain Merkle tree, right? And so on. Yeah, and just like blockchain, the property, it has the same properties of like a blockchain, which is that if for example I say that this commit I say that I trust this commit, right? That means that implicitly you can say that everything else that is pointed to by this commit is trusted by me, because this parent hash is a hash of the parent commit, right? Which hashes the tree, right, of the parent commit contents, and it applies for all the parent commits as well. And yeah, so by just signing this single commit, I say that I trust the entire history. Not only trusting this, the contents of this commit, right, but I'm also saying that the entire history is sort of trusted lah. Or I can say that I trust the entire history simply by saying that by signing this and saying that I trust the history. You know, I don't have to say sign the entire tree of commits because of the property of a blockchain or a Merkle tree, right? Which basically what Git is lah. Yeah. So that's an interesting thing about Git. Okay. So that's how Git represents its objects, right? So, the last thing that I should mention is that basically all of these objects, objects in a Git, in a Git repository, right? And they're identified by their hash, right? So, when I say that a Git repository is just a bunch of objects, right? That is what it is. Like, later on, we'll see in a Git directory that is a objects. There's just an objects directory with all the different objects in the directory. And So all objects are just referred to by the hash, right? And this is also why you know, people were getting worried that Git actually used SHA-1, because like you know, SHA-1 is considered broken now. So if someone wanted, they could engineer, and people have, like, in fact, engineered repositories with clashing hashes, you know. And yeah, Git will sort of behave strangely when you do that, because Git doesn't distinguish, Git doesn't sort of namespace commits versus trees versus blobs, right? So if you were to have a, like, one commit that has the same hash as a blob, for example, then like when so strange things start to happen when you try to create a new object with the same hash as an existing object. Like, Git will say that, oh, this object already exists, right? And then not create it. But it turns out that that object may is actually not what you want. So you end up with sort of silent silent corruption of the repository. Of course, this is really unlikely to happen in normal use, because, like, I mean, SHA-1 is 160-bit, right? So the chances of you running into a collision unintentionally is really astronomically low, right? But someone could engineer a repository where there is a conflict, and yeah, or it could be abused in such a way to such that they could replace an object in a repository without you knowing, lah. That's why Git is now looking at moving into, they're almost done, actually. So recently they released 2.29, I believe, and Git 2.29 contains most of the changes needed. Or in fact, they already have the ability to change to a different hash. So SHA-256. Yeah. So now the Git code base is sort of abstracted. The hash handling is sort of abstracted so that they can change to different hashes in future. And the ability to use SHA-256 is already there. I think you have to specify some flags for it. They're still working on it, lah, because it's still alpha. Like, what they want to have eventually is that to be able to sort of use repositories of sort of backwards compatibility, like, basically. You can have a repository that contains both kinds of objects. Okay, so that is this is the overall idea of how Git works, right? And so we noticed that it is basically like a blockchain, and the other thing that that the blockchain is a directed acyclic graph, right? So Git commits also form a directed acyclic graph, right? As we see here, right, this is a graph, but of course it looks a bit messy if you draw it like that, so let's look at it in a different way. So you have a commit, let's say A. So this is the oldest commit, and then B, C, E, right? Maybe you have a branch, right? So this is a graph, right, in the mathematical / computer science sense. I assume most people here are from computer science, so you know what a graph means, right? Not like this kind of graph, but like a graph with nodes and edges. This a Git commit history forms a directed acyclic graph. Why do I say directed? Because each commit points has an edge leading to its parent node or parent commit, right? So it's directed. It's acyclic because you cannot have a cycle. That means you cannot have something like this. It's not possible, unless you. I mean, you can't create this in normal usage of Git, lah. You can sort of, if you sort of do some. I don't know how you would do this, but if you do some sort of SHA-1 collision, you might be able to engineer a cycle out of this, but you can't achieve this in normal usage. So we will consider it as acyclic, right? So normally you cannot you will have a commit that starts everything off, right? So git, the commit history has to be acyclic. And finally, it's a graph, right? Because these are your nodes, or you can call it vertices, and these are your edges, and they're directed edges because they point from the child commit to the parent commit, right? So we have a directed acyclic graph, right? And so basically everything you do is an operation on this graph, right? And we will talk about how each of the operations you can sort of model them based on the graph later on. Okay. So yeah, commits form a directed acyclic graph. And so when you have a branch, right? For example, again, let me blank out the screen. So when you have a branch, again, let's draw out our commit graph. When you have a graph, when you have a bunch of commits, right? And let's say you have a master pointer, so like so what a branch is basically just something that points to this commit. So like master points to this commit, right? So it will just specify the commit hash of C, right? And then you can have an active branch, right? And that is what we call the head. And then the head is a special ref that points to another ref, right? Which is the currently active ref, right? So what happens when you actually create a commit? What it does is it will create a new commit. Okay, you look at head, and in fact, it won't even look at head. It will look ahead and look at what head is pointing to, and this whatever it's pointing to will become the new parent commit of the new commit, right? And then git will create a new commit, and then with the contents of whatever your index is, and then make the new commit have a parent commit of whatever head is pointing to, right? And then it's going to then update whatever head is pointing to, like the branch that is pointing to point to a new commit. So then it will change this to point to here. That's how committing works, right? It's very straightforward. I mean, it's quite I think nice and simple. Just create a new commit object, and then you just update the whatever branch you're pointing on to point to that new commit object, right? So a branch again is just a name. It's just a name for a commit. So when you move or reset a branch, you're just saying, okay, let me make this branch point somewhere else, right? The commits are still there in the graph. You can always make them go back, right? And now head will continue to point to master, of course. And we will see how this pointing actually is done in the git directory at the end of the last section. Okay. Are there any questions so far? Feel free to just interrupt or unmute yourself or ask in the chat.
Yeah. Hi, Harvey.
Hi.
Yeah. So you can't reset the head when you're at the very first commit, right? You have to do some special manipulation to remove the very first commit in a branch.
You can't remove the first commit in a branch. You can use the often often option. That's what I would do.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to create a new branch that doesn't point to any doesn't have any history la.
Correct.
All right, so let's move on. Okay, so there is this repository which you can clone. So our exercises today will be based on this repository. So I'm just gonna and gonna clone the repository. Okay. So please, okay, you don't have to clone the repository. You can do the exercises on any repository you want. Although I did create some exercise cases, so like some simulated, especially for bisect as well as, what's the other one? Cleaning up a PR, right? Yes, it will be good if you clone this repository so that you can follow along with those exercises. So just clone this repository. I've pasted the link in the chat and then we can get started. Okay. So let's start off with a commit and history manipulation. This is most likely you already know this. It's just a refresher. So the first thing we're going to look at is a very basic thing. It's amending a commit, right? So I'm sure you have used this before, probably. What this does, right, in terms of our graph, if you have two commits, and this is your mask, your whatever your head is, lah, right? If this is whatever your head is, what does amend do, right? So normally when you create a new commit, it will then make it point, it'll make it based on the this while head is pointing to, and then move head to it, right? When you do an amend, what happens instead is that it will, so let me see, this is normal and this amend, okay, so when you create an amend, right, what it's going to do is to basically create a new commit C, right? And then instead of making it point to B, it's just going to replace B and make it point to A. So C will be based on whatever contents B has plus whatever additional changes you make on top. And then as per normal, it's going to make the head point to whatever branch head is pointing to point to C, lah. But I'll omit that for because I don't have space, right? So that's the difference between amend. So it's just going to sort of throw away this commit, right? Replace it with a new commit. So you're amending the commit, lah. Right. So that can be useful if you forget, if you just, you created a commit and you forgot to add something, or you forgot, you want to edit the message, or you want to do whatever, right? And yeah, this is one of the commands to use, right? So let's look at the exercises. Okay. So let's do the first exercise together. Let's amend head to sort of to be authored by yourself, right? On this date. So This may not work. Let's use ISO date format. Yes. Ta-da. So I'm not sure exactly what date formats Git accepts, but ISO date format is always safe, right? So yes. You can amend the commit to change the date, right? And now if you look at the commit, you can see the date is this. And then of course what is actually not shown is actually the normally not shown is the commit date or commit time, right? It's actually possible to override the commit time as well. If you were to look at the man page and then at the end they tell you that they tell you that you can actually look at the you can replace the commit information using these environment variables as well, right? So if you really want to set the commit date and time as well, there is, as far as I could find, there is no option for this. You have to set it via the environment variable, so we can do that as well. Right, just gonna right, and then if we now look at the commit date, it is the same as the author date, right? And this is of course a Unix timestamp. So that's why I would say a git history is useful only for looking at the logical changes, or like the logical changes between in the repository. Like, it's not useful for proving anything, because it's not useful. You can use it to prove things, right? Because most of the time people do not amend the history. But if someone really wanted to overwrite the history such that to prove something, right, you can't, you cannot really trust that a git history has not been amended. Of course, you can look at GitHub. GitHub tracks the pushes to Git separately, so you can always look at the GitHub pushes for a bit more information as to when something was created, but it's still hard to tell. Can amend be undone? Yes, that's actually one of our exercises later on. Using the reflog. Yeah, so we will see that in a bit. Okay, let's look at the next exercise. So amend hit to have an extra file, right? So again, what commit does is to just create a new commit based on your current index, right? So if you just want to change the contents of the commit, you can just do it by just doing it as per normal. So let's say I want to add a new file. And just edit. And I just git commit amend, and now I have created a new file within the commit. Right, so that's how you, so the way to use commit amend is just do whatever changes you would do normally, and then stage or delete files, whatever it is, modify files, and then you, instead of doing a commit, you just do commit amend, and it will just merge the changes into the current commit. Of course, it's not actually merging, it's just that it's creating a new commit based on the index, right? Which will have the changes that you have just staged, as well as which is based on the current commit. Okay. Shall we move on? Okay, next we have interactive rebase. So we have the normal rebase, right? And so let's again look at how what these operations do onto the do to the commit graph. So a normal rebase, let's say you are on you are here, right? So I'm here. Let's say my branch, okay. And my head is pointing here. That means this is my currently active branch. And I say rebase, and this is master, okay? And then I say rebase master. That means I'm rebasing onto master, right? So what? How does this work? Git will find the common ancestor between us and master. So in that case, that is B, right? That's common ancestor. So it's going to chop off here, right? And then sort of reapply these commits on top of D. That's what rebase does, lah. So you can say that B is our base, right? Relative to master, and then we are going to rebase it. And then we're going to rebase it on top of master. That means Git is going to look at the diff of B and E, and then apply it on top of D. So it's gonna be end up with E prime, right? But actually, what is more correct to look at it as this edge that is moved over here, right? Because this edge sort of represents the changes. This edge sort of represents the changes between B and E. So when you rebase, it will actually sort of, in a way, you can see it as you're moving this edge over from here, which of course it represents the changes, and then you have a new commit object based on that. Shimei, I hope you don't mind I answer your question by audio. So you said that do you have to git push? Push and pull is dealing with a remote repository basically. So how to say, when you do any operations in Git, right, they happen on your local repository. So if you amend ready, it's already done locally. And then if you say you want to push it, if you have already pushed the commits to a remote repository, then yes, and you want your amended commit to replace whatever is in the remote branch, then you should use git push force. But today we're not really looking at remotes because because a remote branch is really just it's just like another branch. You can look at it as just another branch in terms of Git. It just happens that the branch is not on your computer, but it's on someone else's computer, right? If you push to a branch, you're just sending all the objects that are needed in that branch. You're just sending all the objects needed by the current branch, right? Over to the remote computer, and then you're telling them, okay, now make this branch point to this commit. So that's what a push does. To answer your question directly again, once you commit amend, the changes are made. It's just that it's made locally. If you want them to appear on the remote repository, right, wherever it is, someone else's computer or GitHub or something like that, then you have to use push. Yeah. But the changes are already done once you have commit amended. Of course, you won't see it on GitHub until you actually push. Does that answer your question? You will just push as per normal, or I will say, in the sense that the amended commit it's just like any other commit you would just push it if you want it to be seen, if you want it to be in the remote repository. Like if you don't want it to be in the remote, then you don't need to do anything. Yeah. Okay. Back to rebase, right? So this is what rebase does. So once we are going to move this over here to be placed on top. So it's just gonna be based on top of E. So then we will have another commit F. Yeah. Okay. So let's look at rebase now. I will just hide this in case anyone wants to see it later. Okay, so I'm sure everyone has used a normal rebase, right? There is the interactive rebase, which is lets you sort of customize what the interactive rebase lets you customize what rebase does, right? So by default, rebase just applies all the commits on top of whatever you say on top of the base, right? But there are other things that you can do to sort of make it you can sort of change what rebase does. I think some of these are useful. So like you want to change the commit message, edit the commit, or squash or combine two commits, right? Those are the most common ones that I think most people use. Right. Let us see how this is. Well, let's give this a try lah. Okay. So So this is a commit hash, right? So if we look at the git log, this is this commit, right? And there is a typo here that is carried across to all the other all the other commits. Before we do anything, we don't have to do it now. But for the subsequent exercises, I'll mention this again. It may be good to reset back to the original master. We'll do that later. For now, we don't have to. So basically, So the first exercise is just to fix the spelling error in this commit. So what is actually the spelling error, right? Let's take a look at what happened in this commit. So you can see we changed this message in that commit, right? And there is a typo here. And so we want to fix that typo, right? So how do we do this? There are multiple ways of doing this. Does anyone know what the ways are? Or can anyone think of the two ways? At least two. There's definitely more than two, right? There's quite a few ways of doing these kinds of things in Git. Anyone? Why can't you create a commit with just the correct spelling? The reason I would rebase and amend and fix the spelling error instead of just creating a new commit with the correct spelling, right? Is suppose you're creating a pull request, right? There are repositories that there are projects that expect your pull requests to be divided into small logical chunks of commits that are sort of, each commit should be self-contained and make a logical change, right? And for those sort of projects, for example, Linux, right? The commit history of a pull request is not meant to be a representation of the actual work that was done. It's meant to be a division of the entire change into a set of smaller changes that are reviewable, right? So in that case, they will not appreciate it if you have a typo in an earlier change set, right? And then later on have extra change to fix it. They'll ask you, can you make a new version of this entire pull request with this change, with the typo fixed, right? And that's why on Linux, in the Linux kernel, you will see things like, let me see. Yeah. So I don't know if you know, but yeah, if you follow Linux, then you might know that recently, this company has been trying to push a, or commit, not commit, to contribute a NTFS driver into the kernel, right? And so this is how, So you see here, we have patch version 11, right? So this patch set has gone through 11 revisions, right? And there is a changelog here. But you can see these are the sort of commits that this entire patch was divided into, right? You can see this does not represent how you would develop this. Whatever it is, you don't start off with all the headers first, and then it, like when you write a project, you don't write all the headers up front, right? You will add to them as you go, right? But this is just one way to. This is just how they divided the patch set up, after all the changes were made, right? So again, So this is why you would rebase and amend a commit rather than just creating a new commit with that changes the typo, right? It's for when you want to create a pull request. Because a pull request, even on GitHub, right? Not just on Linux, even on GitHub, a pull request should have a clean history, right? Which number one, that makes it easier for the reviewers to review, right? Number two, the main point is just that it's easier for the reviewers to review lah. Okay, so back to our rebase. Reset to that commit and then fix the spelling error. Yes, but then you would have to, let me see. But then you will lose any history after that, right? In the sense that you will lose any commits after that commit. Because you can see here, this is our commit, right? And then there are commits on top of it, but we want to fix the spelling error here while still maintaining all these commits after that. I mean, okay, of course the hashes will change, but we want the changes that are made by these commits. Okay, so how? The first way that comes to my mind is to use rebase, of course. Which is why I made this exercise, right? So we want to rebase on top of the parent commit of this commit. That's why we specify this tilde here. So we just specify this commit, and if you put a tilde at the end, right, you can see this tilde here. This will refer to the parent of this commit, and if you specify another tilde, then it will refer to the parent of the parent, and so on, right? So we can rebase on top of that, and you can see now the commit that we want to modify is at the top. So what we want to do is change it to E or edit. So we will stop there. Git will stop here for us to edit this commit, right? So we just need to write, save the file, and then we exit. And then Git will tell us that we have stopped at this commit. And now we can sort of fix the commit. So again, we can go git show, and git show will show us that we are on that commit that we want to fix, and then what was the change in that commit. Then we can edit whatever it is. So we edit the thing, right? And then so we add as normal, and then we amend the commit. Now we can. So now, as usual, I will say, if you are not sure what to do now, look at git status. Git status tells you that you are in the middle of a rebase. And then you can. So once we are done amending the commit, right, we will rebase continue. Right? And then, oh no, we end up with a merge conflict, right? Because some other program modifies that line that we also modified. So now we need to fix the conflicts. So what's the issue? Yes. The issue is here, right? Because this line as well as this line were both modified. So we will just have to merge the changes ourselves. And it's going to have a conflict at every line because of this change. Okay. So now, So now we have fixed the typo, right? So if we were to look at the change here, you can see that there's no more typo, right? And if we were to look at the next commit, you can see, the typo has been fixed in all of the subsequent commits as well, which we went through like manually one by one because of all the merge conflicts. Okay, so that is one way to do it. What is another way to do it? So at this juncture, I'm going to reset back to the original tree. So I'm just going to reset to origin master, right? And so I'm back to the original commit that you get by cloning the repository, and we're going to rebase it once again and use a different strategy. So again, we're going to rebase on top of this, and at this point, instead of using edit, I'm going to say break, stop here, right? So now I'm stopped, I need to pick. They're not safe. Oh, okay, it works now. So where am I? Try that again. Yes. So we want to break. We want to break after applying this commit, right? Yeah. So now we are on top of this commit, and we can do whatever we want now. So I'm just gonna. And I'm just going to make the fix as usual, right? So we have made the fix. Now we can see that the fix has been made. And then we can add. We'll add the thing. And instead of amending, I'm going to make a commit here. Right? And then I'm going to continue the rebase. And then as usual, we will get the same merge conflicts, right? So I'm just going to fix up the conflicts. Right. And again, So now we have fixed a thing, but there is an extra commit here that we don't really want, right? So I'm going to rebase once again. Now I need to get the, yeah. So this commit hasn't changed yet. Yeah. So now I'm just going to, I'm going to rebase again and change this to a fix up. So that means we're going to merge this commit on top of, we're going to merge this commit into this one, right? So we will do that. And now you can see that commit is now fixed, right? There's no more extra fixed commit. Because we did a fix up on that commit. Yeah, you could have used amend as well. I mean, that was the first method. That's the first method. Which ultimately is the same, I guess. Whether you use edit, that means whether you specify edit to edit the commit or you specify break after the commit, right? You could have done either because the way that Git performs the operations is the same. Yeah. When do I use fix up? Normally, okay, this was a bit of a contrived example, right? That I couldn't. It suited the first method more. Right, which is basically going back there, mending, and then letting the rebase continue on top. But most of the time, if you were to have a large patch, a large pull request you are less likely to encounter merge conflicts, right? Or maybe the typo is in the your commits, okay. I'll say in a larger, you know, pull request or in a larger code base, it's likely that your each of your pull commits in your pull request or patch set do not touch the same files, right? So some of them touch this file, some of them touch another file. And it's just that so what you can do is just to create a you just create the change on the latest commit, right? So you just do it right now. Like for example, I'll modify it on top of the latest commit, right? And then I'll have a new commit on top of it. Then after that, I will do so let me just do that. Let me pretend to do that, okay? So I'll just do that by creating a new file. So yeah, let's say I forgot to add a file to a particular commit, right? So that change, this won't end up with any conflicts as long as none of the other commits actually create this file. So then I want to merge this this missing file is supposed to be in one of the earlier commits, right? So I'm just gonna, right? I'm just gonna take this commit and move it to here, and then I'm going to change it to a fix up, right? It's not going to conflict because it's just creating a new file, so it's going to fix up. And then now so now if I look at maybe it wasn't that one, yes it was this one. Oh wait, I think it's because of my yes, there we go. So there we see that it was created. Yeah. So that's where I will usually use fix up versus amend. Right? See what fits the situation better lah. Okay. So I won't really touch the other exercises because if you look at the if you look at the rest of the the other exercises are quite trivial. So to reorder a commit, you just change the order of these pick statements, right? And to drop a commit, you either change it to drop or you just remove the line entirely, right? And then there will not, so Git will not apply that commit again, and it will be gone. Okay. Yeah, I'm no one to rebase, so I'm just gonna clear the rebase to-do line. Okay, so now I'm going to reset back again to the original. Okay, let's move on from rebase. We have a lot more to cover. Okay, so what is cherry pick? Again, let's look at cherry pick in the context of our graph, right? Let me clear this. So what does cherry pick do, right? Basically, if you have if you have a bunch of let's call this F, I guess. If you have a bunch of commits on a, you have two branches, right? You have a bunch of commits, and you now want, let's say this is the main development branch, lah, and this is a release branch. So this is a maintenance branch, but you're just maintaining this release, and this is the main development branch. And let's say, for whatever reason, you want to you fix a bug in the main branch, right? And let's say you want to pull it into the release branch, but you don't want the rest of the commits on the main branch, right? You just want the bug fix. So let's say this is a bug fix. Let's call this G. So this is a bug fix, right? So how would you apply this commit on top of the release branch? This is basically what you use cherry pick for. Lah. So you would say cherry pick G, right? And then you'll just apply the change onto the release branch. So that is what cherry pick does. In the context of the graph. So let us cherry pick let's just cherry pick this commit. So actually, what is this commit? This commit is on a branch that split off from master like one commit or two commits before the current master hit. So so you can see that this is master, and this is our this is a branch, right? And there is one more commit on that branch, so we cannot simply say rebase this branch on top of master, right? Because then we will get this commit as well, which we do not want. So we just want this commit. So what we're going to do is just cherry pick, right? And how do you cherry pick? It's very simple. You just cherry pick and specify the commit or commit hashes. And you're done. Very easy. Of course, the cherry pick commit will have a different hash, right? Because the hash of the parent of this commit is going to be this one and not whatever the parent of this was, right? So because the parent is different, therefore the commit itself is different. Yeah. Even though they technically represent the same change, right? But again, GitHub, not GitHub, but Git is a snapshot-based version control system, so it does not track patches, but it tracks content. Okay, so that is cherry pick. Everyone okay so far? Let's move on then. Okay, so let us use what we know now to clean up a pull request. So I created this pull request yesterday based on some messy pull requests that I have seen, right? So when you have a bunch of when you have two parallel branches of development, right? So let's say this is the main branch, and then so this is the main branch, and then someone else decided to make a fork, not a fork, but like a feature branch to develop their particular feature before being merged into master, right? And then they periodically merge back changes into, you know, they periodically merge back the changes. Okay, the direction of this is should be this way, right? They periodically merge back the changes from master. Then like so, like that. For whatever reason, they do that. And now you want to merge this back into master, but you don't want all these disgusting merge commits, right? You just want the actual content, which in this case would be this, right? So how do you clean this up? And while still retaining the actual history that was in the feature branch, right? So you don't want to lose the fact that this was two separate commits, but you want to drop these merge commits, right? How do you do that? So there are multiple ways of fixing, of course, there are multiple ways of fixing a pull request history. It depends, of course, on how much history you want to keep and so on. So again, let's look at this. You can get the pull request by checking out the abstract branch. So I'm just gonna show it to you. I'm gonna use Gateway for this because the branch is a bit messy. So the branch is a bit messy, so again I'm going to use a git. Can I resize these? No, I cannot. Hold on a second. Never mind, I'm just going to use the command line. So you can see our slightly messy branch history, right? Basically we have our branch and then it's like there's like merge commits, and then there's some work, and then there's some work, and then there's a merge commit, and then this is work on the master branch, and then like merge commit, you know. So it's, if we were to just okay, if you were to just merge it, right? So if we go back to master. Boom, we get A. Look at our commit history now, it's so messy. It's like different layers of merges, right? Which is terrible. Look, there's five parallel lines here, right? So we do not want this. Of course, right? So let us undo that. And how would you clean up this history? Anyone? There's a few ways. If you don't care about the history, one of the ways is just to squash the entire PR, right? And of course you don't get any of the messy history. But you're good because you get none of the history. Yes, one of the ways is to rebase. So let's check out abstract. And simply just rebase on master. But there will be merge conflicts. So where are we now? But so you can just rebase. That will actually help. But the problem is, when you rebase, you will have to rebase all the merge commits as well. And it's not guaranteed that those merge commits will be able to be rebased cleanly. Rebase interactively to remove those merge commits. You can't do that. The reason is that the merge commits are not actually empty. Not say empty, but in the sense that the merge commits actually resolve the conflicts between the two branches at the point of the merge, right? So they are not actually empty. They're not actually empty. You can't just drop the merge commits. Yeah, and you will see that actually Git doesn't include merge commits. You'll see that these merge commits are not included in the rebase because it doesn't quite make sense, right? To actually rebase with a merge commit. The reason being that when you rebase again, you know you have your commit history. And then let's say you have this and then like let's say this came from this and this, right? Let's say this happened, okay? When you rebase, right, Git has to compute the difference. Let's say, when you rebase, Git has to compute the difference or the patch between this commit and this commit, right? And then apply it on top of another of the new base, right? But if you have a merge commit, right? Which base are you going to, apply on top of, you see? So it is a bit, it's not very clear what exactly you should do when you rebase with merge commits. So you can rebase, but in that case, what you're going to do is you'll end up, ultimately, you are going to have to end up, you are going to have to resolve all the conflicts by hand, right? If you want to preserve the history, you have to do it. There is not much way around it. Okay, so let's look at how you might do this. So one way is to just do the rebase and fix the conflicts by hand, even though they have already been fixed in the merge, right? But this may still be the easiest way. So we're just going to rebase on master, right? And so now we need to resolve the conflicts, right? So I'm just going to anyhow resolve them. I cannot quite remember how I resolved them. So that's when you look at the merge commit, because the merge commit will actually tell you how you resolve the... I see. I also cannot remember how I resolved the commits, so I'm just going to do it just whatever. Let's just do it this way, okay? Yeah, and then we end up with another merge conflict. Yes. So yep, and another merge conflict, which we will fix. Right. So let us you can see that I probably have introduced some merge errors already. Because like cannot remember how exactly I resolved the conflicts earlier. Yes. So now you can see that our history is now linear. But did we actually end up with the same history as did we end up with the same contents as abstract? Let's see. Oh, we did. So that ended up okay. Right. So that is one way to do it. Basically just rebase and work through the merge conflicts. The other way is to squash, throw away your history, right? And the third way. So I'm going to reset back to the messy branch. There is a flag to rebase to preserve merges, right? So we can try that. So now you can see that now you can see that we have our merge commits rebased as well on top of master, which is kind of strange, but now we can rebase again, right? And that's not meant to happen. Let's give this a try, and we'll set up. We will still end up with conflicts because the merge commits are not empty. So for this particular case, I do not believe that there is any easier way than to actually work through each of the conflicts manually. Ultimately you have to do it because Git doesn't really know how to automatically you know, resolve all of these, even though the merge conflicts do contain information on it. To the best of my knowledge, you have to still fix it manually, because the merge conflicts, as in the merges, the merge commits, it's hard for Git to tell exactly how to use the information in the merge commits to resolve the rebase conflicts, right? So the easiest strategy again is to just, not easiest, but the most likely strategy that will work is to just rebase and then fix all of the conflicts that happen. If you don't want to do that, you can always just squash the entire branch, right? And the other way that I have done in the past, right, for exceptionally messy branches, is to actually just manually cherry pick each of the changes. So like I'll look at the history and identify, you know, I'll identify each of the content, the changes that actually are important, and then I'm just going to cherry pick them manually and then fix the conflicts that result from that. Yeah, but if it's too difficult, I will just squash, because like there's nothing else that I can do lah. And sometimes it's just not worth the time, depending on the PR, to have to preserve the history lah. Yeah. Okay. Did anyone find any other ways of cleaning up the history? No? Okay. Let's move on then. Okay. Let's talk about patches. So what is actually a patch? Right. A patch is just, let's go back to master. It won't be rejected lah. You just have to resolve the merge conflicts. Yeah. They all operate a similar way lah. If you will try to apply the patch, and if it doesn't work, then there'll be merge conflicts and you have to fix them. Okay, let's look at patches. So, what is a patch? Oops. Yes. So a patch file is basically a file, let's say I modify one of the files. Let's make this return. So I modified the file. And if you look at the div, you can see the change, right? Okay, so just in case you're curious, I'm using this thing called Git Delta, which sort of pretty prints out the div for me to see. But without it, the default output of Git div is actually a patch file. This is a patch file, right? So this file, not a file, but this data here represents the changes that were made. So you can see here, basically the format is that there's an extra line of spaces here. There's extra line of spaces here. And so for a line that was not changed, so we call this a context line. Basically the patch algorithm uses it to match lines with the lines will change lah. For a line that was not changed, it's just a space, right? And then if the line was deleted, it's a minus. And then if the line was added, then it's a plus. So you can see here, we remove this line, and then we added this line. So this is a patch file, right? So you can just, it's possible to, take this contents and then send it to someone else to apply. So that's how Linux does their, that's how Linux collaboration works, based on the mailing list, and then you just send patches over the mailing list. But, yeah. So to generate a patch, right, what you just need to do is just, one of the ways is just to use git diff. And you can just dump it to a patch. And then you have a, you now you have a diff. You can send this diff to someone else and then they can apply the diff, right? Okay. So let us try to apply a patch. So first thing is to just take this and put it into a file. So I'm just gonna paste it into Nano, right? I'll just paste it into a patch file, right? And you can see that Nano gives me syntax highlighting for my patch file. Yes. So now I can just use git apply. Oh no, it doesn't apply. Why? Oh, okay. That's because I already modified my hello. So again, apply our patch. And now we can see that the patch was applied, right? This was the patch, right? So again, what to do is, how to apply a patch, just get the patch into a file. Then you can say git apply patch.diff, and if the patch can be applied, then it will apply it. If there are conflicts, then git will tell you there are conflicts, and then you can then manually look at the patch and then go and apply. So git, you can tell git if you look at the manual, this option. So by default, it will try to apply the patch and then it will reject it if it doesn't work, right? But if you want it to sort of apply what it can and then just leave the rest for you to handle, then you can just specify the reject flag. Yeah, if there are multiple diffs in multiple hunks in this patch, but this patch only has one hunk, right? So there is no point. But if this patch is longer and there are multiple hunks, right? This is a hunk, right? If there are multiple hunks and then you can then specify --reject. So then git will try to apply the patches that it can apply, right? And the patches that it cannot apply, because for whatever reason, let's say the file was changed, you changed a line, those lines were changed already by you, or between the time that you, the person created this patch and the time that you were applying it, right? So that means there's a conflict, then git will just apply whatever else that it can, and then it will reject this one. So that is apply. Okay, then let's look at format patch, right? So format patch is really how collaboration is kind of done at in the Linux kernel, right? So you see here, this is an email, right? So normally how Linux is done is collaboration is done is you have the email, and this is actually taken, so this will become the commit message, right? It's also the email subject, and then after that you have the commit message, like the parts after the commit title, and then you have like whatever metadata extra metadata here, followed by a diff stat. So this is just a stat of the changes. And then finally we have the patch or patches, right? So these are the different hunks in a patch. So a single patch can change multiple files, right? Yeah. So this is how how do you actually create such a file, right? You can use git format patch. And basically you just specify you just specify the range of commits you want to create a patch for. Like, let's say I want to create a patch for these two commits, right? Then I just need to specify this one, because basically we are saying that since this commit, there are these two commits, so let's just create a patch for these two commits, right? So we can do that. Just do that. And then Git will tell us, okay, we have created these two files, right? And so then if you look at these two files, you will see that they are actually an email format, right? This is a special date time just to let Git know that it is a patch created by format patch. Yeah, and then you see that this is the commit message, and there will be more paragraphs here if they were elaborate. And then yeah, this is exactly the same format that we saw here, lah. Right. So then if you have a compatible email client, which is none of the webmail clients, but like Thunderbird works, and like a command line client, then you could send this as an email, right? And the person receiving it will be able to apply the patch. The reason you need the reason you cannot just paste this into like Gmail on the web, right, is because Gmail tends to mangle spaces. So like these spaces Gmail will sort of alter the spaces, and if you have tab characters inside, right, they have to be preserved, but Gmail will sort of eat them up as well, and then you will have lots of problems because the tabs don't match up, and then basically the entire patch doesn't work, lah. Yeah. And also Gmail always likes to send both a text email and a HTML email. Like so in email you can a single email can a single email can what do you call that have multiple versions of the same email, right? So but there are certain mailing lists that will reject the email if you have a HTML version of the email. So if you do that, if you send using like Gmail, I think Gmail does that, right? Then you end up with problems. Can you use a clipping tool like XSelect? What do you mean? Oh, you mean like to copy the patch into your clipboard? Yeah, no, but the problem is not that. The problem is not at the clipboard side. It's actually in the Gmail side. Thank you. Yeah, it's actually in the Gmail side. Gmail itself mangles up the white space. So yeah, you have to use an external email client with Gmail if you really want to. I mean, there are people who do Linux development using a Gmail address, but you have to use an external client, lah. So like something like Mutter or Thunderbird or something like that. Yeah. Okay, and then let's look at AM. So apply mail, right? AM stands for apply mail. This is how you apply patches that are received on the mailing list, right? So I'm just going to reset all the way back to, I'm going to clean my repository and then go back to the state of my origin master. Okay. Yeah. And so the exercise here is to apply the two patches that are in the repository, right? So how do you apply? Very simple. You just do this. Just specify the patches that you want to apply and press enter. And then Git will apply the patches. And you can look at the And you can see that the patches were applied, right? So so you can look at the new file and it's there, right? So yeah, this is how Linux kernel maintainers apply patches that they receive on the mailing list. Right. Okay. Everyone managed to apply the two patches that are in the repository. It's kind of funny to have patches in the repository that you then apply on top of the commits, including the patches. But yeah, it was the most convenient way for me to distribute the patch files by including them in the repository. Okay, let's move on then. There are no issues. So, you can get a patch from things on GitHub by just appending a .patch to the URL. So like if I want to see a patch of this PR, I can just add .patch to the end of PR URL, and then I will get the patch file, right? And you can see that I'll get multiple there are multiple commits, right? So I'll see each of the different patches, but by default it doesn't include merge commits lah, which is what you want lah, usually. But of course, yeah, when you have merge commits, it kind of doesn't work well because like you see, the third patch 3 out of 4 is like that. Patch 4 out of 4, suddenly it becomes like that. So this is obviously not going to apply well. But yeah, you have to fix your history before you create a patch files. Okay, let us move on. Okay, let's... Is changelog maintained between different releases? You mean like the git changelog? Like of the Git project itself? I guess so. They manually maintain it. I'm not sure what you mean actually. Oh, I think changelog is maintained by the Git maintainer rather than individual contributors. Like, so they will update the changelog when every time they create a release, instead of each contributor writing to the changelog themselves. Yeah, if not, it'll be a mess, lah, honestly. Okay, let's look at bisect, right? So what is bisect? Bisect is basically a binary search for a commit, right? So you have a bunch of commits, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? Some of these commits, so at some point there was a bug introduced, let's say at commit 6. So then after that, all of these commits are broken, right? And then you want to find, right, which of these commits are which was the commit that introduced the bug. So the sort of naive way would just go through each of these commits one by one until you find the commit that is broken, right? But you know, if you have like thousands of commits, which is typical for like say the Linux kernel, then you can't exactly do that easily, or it's gonna take a long time. So instead of doing that, right, what we can do is a binary search lah. Because like if you have such a property where you know that before a certain point, something was true or false, and then after a certain commit, that property became the opposite. So something was working and then it became broken or something like that. You can use this for other things also. Like if something was slow and then some commit unintentionally made it faster, right? Or optimize it. Then you want to find what was actually the change that made it fast. You can say before. So before was slow, after was fast. And you can use it. You can use bisect to find that as well. I mean, so ultimately bisect is just a binary search, right? And I assume everyone here knows what a binary search is. Right, so yeah. So let us bisect this repository. So check out the bisect branch. Right. If you look at the log, you will notice there are 2000 commits, right? So this is not something you can go through by hand. Of course, I generated the commits using a script. So this is not something you can go through by hand, right? Okay, so let's look at the branch. So there's just one file called file, right? And if you check the file, you will see that it contains broken 2000, right? So basically, at some point, the commits are basically just consisting of the file with a numbering from 1 to 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way to 2000, right? But at some point, I started adding broken in front of the number. So the exercise is to find the first commit that has broken in the file, right? You can try it by hand first, or you can just go straight for the bisect run. Okay. So yeah. So let us look at git bisect, how git bisect works. So you can do git bisect help. And this will give you a brief summary. So essentially what you want to do is to go git bisect start, right? And then you first specify the bad commit. So that means you want to specify a range of commits, including that will include the sort of commit that broke it, Right. So you want to start by right. So you just want to specify a bad commit, which is known bad. So you know, if you know this current commit is bad, then you can just specify hit. And then if you know a commit that when it was good, then you can specify it as well. If not, you can leave it off. If you leave it off, then git is just going to bisect the entire history starting from this commit, right? So if you do know a commit where it was good, then it would be good to specify it, because that will reduce the number of bisections that you have to do because you search through less commits, right? But if you don't know, then you can just leave it off and it will search through the entire history. So we can do git bisect start hit, right? And we do have to specify a bad commit. So I'm going to specify the known good commit as the first commit on the branch, right? So we do git bisect start, and this is the bad commit, which is the current commit as we know. And this is the first commit on the branch. Because I don't know where I don't know where the bad commit was. Let's just start the bisection. Okay. So now it tells me about 10 steps left. So what we want to do is basically just check file. Is file broken or good? So this is good, right? So git bisect good. And then we have half the number of steps, commits that we need to look at, right? So now this is broken. So we can say git bisect bad. And then this one is still broken, so bad. It's good. This is good, right? It's bad. Good. Good. Bad. Good. This is bad. And now git tells us this is the first bad commit, right? And indeed, you can see 1212 was okay, and then 1213 was broken, right? So therefore, the answer is that the first commit is this one, containing 1213, this commit. Okay? So that's how you bisect the repository. So of course, you will do more complicated steps lah, normally. So like, maybe you will compile your program and then test and run it and check and test whether the particular functionality is broken lah. Yeah, that's what you normally do in between each of the steps, right? And then you can tell git whether it was a bad or good, right? Yeah. It's possible as well to sort of use different terms, right? If it makes it easier, but ultimately it's just one is X and one is Y. Like it was good and then it was bad, and then we want to find the first bad commit. Yeah. So this is how you bisect manually, right? Now let's look at how you can bisect automatically. So essentially, if you use bisect run. Okay, once we're done, we can do git bisect reset, right? So let's start the bisection again. So we will start the bisection again, and let's look at how git bisect run works. Yeah. So if you have a script that can tell you, and like maybe, you know, help you automatically compile your program and run whatever test case it is, right? If you have a script that can tell you if it's good or bad, then you can run the script. So basically, the script is supposed to return successful, which is error code 0, if it's good, and exit with a non-zero exit code, if it is bad lah. Right. And then git will automatically run and bisect for you. Right. So in this, in our case, basically we want to, a good file will just contain numbers, right? A bad file will have extra broken in front. So this regex will not match that. So basically this will return successfully and match. This grep will match the good commits, right? Which just contain a number in file, and it will not match the broken commits which contain broken plus a number in file, right? So we can then just run the bisection and git will automatically run it for us. Right? And then it will automatically arrive at the broken commit which we are currently on. Right, so we see we are on 1213, which is broken. So this is bisect. Y'all managed to bisect and find the same commit? Anyone? All right. If there are no questions, let's move on to the next topic. Right. Reflog. Oh, oops. Yeah. So let's go back to master. Oh no. Reset. Okay, let me reset back to Origin Master. Okay, so what is the ref log? The ref log is just a command that lets you view the log of a ref. Sorry. And what is a ref? Basically, a ref is just it's just a term that get is basically either a branch or a tag, right? So, yeah, or a head. So you can use reflog to see what commits a branch has pointed to on your local what do you call that? On your local git on your local repository, like you cannot look at other repositories reflog. So reflog doesn't get pushed or anything. It's just based on what you have done locally, right? So I can type git reflog. Git reflog, and you can see that we have done quite a few things today, right? So we first cloned from this, and then after that we did quite a few things, did a few rebases and all, right? So just now someone, I think T, had a question, how do we sort of undo a commit amend, right? So this is how you would undo a commit amend lah. We see here, this is the result. So this commit was created by a commit amend. So if you want to undo a commit amend, you can just look at the ref log and then just go back to the previous commit. This commit is, as long as a commit shows up in the ref log, it will still be kept in Git's database, right? Yeah. So you can just revert to any of these commits and it'll be fine. So this is the ref log, right? So let's just do the exercise simply. I'm just going to do some destructive, let's modify the date to be now. We don't want it to be now. Okay, so let's say we amended and we made a mistake and we want to get back the original one. So we go look at the ref log and we just need to check. We just need to get this hash. Then we can reset back to it. And then we are back to the, we're back to the original. We are back to the original pre-amend commit, right? So that's reflog. Yeah. So in general, as long as you have something committed, right? In Git, I wouldn't be too worried about it losing your data. The only time that you might lose your data, so-called, is when the only time you might lose your data is when you haven't committed it, right? Then you might end up overwriting your working tree or things like that. But once you have committed it, it's not that easy to lose whatever it is. Or even stash it, you know. So like, if you know Git stash also affects the ref log. So like, as long as it has, if you have even stashed it, right, then it will be quite safe. So don't worry too much about losing your data. Of course, if you damage the Git directory or your file system has an issue, then Git can't save you from that lah. Yeah. Okay, so that's the ref log. Next, let's look at rewriting a repository. So, if you notice, there is a secret file in this secret file in this repository, right, which contains secret stuff that should not be public, right? So let's say we want to get rid of this secret file, right? How will you do it? You have already committed this repository. You have already pushed, or let's say you haven't pushed it, right? And there's like, you know, you committed this in like quite early on, and then now like you want to then remove the file, right? And you know, the file has some changes made to it, so it's not that easy to just remove it, just rebase and remove it from the initial commit that added the file, because then the subsequent commits that modify the file will all have conflicts, and you know, maybe there's hundreds of them, so you don't want to do that, right? How would you solve this problem? So you will use something called no worries. Thank you. Yeah. So you use something called filter repo, right? Basically. There's an older version of this called filter branch, which is kind of deprecated nowadays. So people recommend that you use git filter repo. So what you want to do is just to go to the git filter repo repository, which I have linked here, right? And just go and get the git filter repo file or script, right? It's actually a Python script. And how do you use git filter repo? Well, it's quite a powerful tool, but what we are trying to do is quite simple, right? So we just want to get rid of the secret file, right? So we just want to git filter repo. Yeah, whatever. So what this does is basically, okay, false is to tell it to just operate regardless of whether it was a fresh clone or not. Invert paths, basically, normally these operations will say select only these paths, right? But if you invert means that select paths that do not match these, So now you can see that my secret is gone, right? Because I have git filter repo removes the paths that has removed the secret that I don't want, right? So now, and the ref log has been cleared as well, so I can just git gc, and we should not be able to find the secret anymore. But anyway, once it has been removed from all the commits, it's safe to push any objects that are not referenced. Will not be pushed to the remote repository, so it's safe to just remove it. So it's safe to now push it, this branch to another branch, to a remote repository or public repository. Yeah, so that is git filter repo. So you do need a Python for this tool, and I'm not sure whether it works on Windows. I believe it should. If you have Python. Thank you. Okay, so that is filter repo. Next, let's look at submodules, right? Submodules are a simple way of including, including another repository in your current repository. So like, suppose you have you want to include a repository in your current repository. So some reasons that you might want to do this is like, say, dependencies. So like if you want to, especially for certain languages which still do not have a package manager, so like a C or C++, right? Which do not have like a white or a package manager that is sort of used by everyone that is using a language, then you might want to use if you have dependencies that are not provided by the user, then you may want to use submodules to include them, right? So that's what a submodule does. So let us just add a submodule, right? So how do you add a submodule? Ta-da, you're done. Right, you just say git submodule add and then the URL, and then it will include the submodule here. Of course, if you want to say include it as a different under a different directory name, then you can just specify the directory name after the URL. Yeah. But other than that, you can just include it. So now if we go into, you can see that the repository, the full repository is here, right? And yeah. So now if you do git diff, now if you do git status, it's gonna tell you new file. Let me remove filter repo. If you do git status, it's gonna tell you new file. A big repo, a new file git module. So this git modules file, we can look at it. It basically contains information about the submodules in the repository lah. And this file basically contains the commit hash. It's the directory, right? But what is actually committed into your Git repository is just a file indicating which commit we are on in the submodule. So we can now commit. Right. And next, let's go into the submodule. And let's make it let's make it point to a different commit, right? So now if you look at git status, you look at git status, it tells us that the submodule has changed commit, right? And this is tracked in the author repository. So we can now add it. We can now add it, and then it will tell us. And then is the change in commit hash of the submodule is tracked within our repository. So again, based on the property of the git graph, if I say I have verified this commit, that also means that I have verified that this commit works with the particular version of the submodule. If you change this hash, then this hash would no longer be the same. So this hash sort of represents all of the information about not only the contents of this repository, but as well as it says that we are pointing to this commit in this repository. So anyway, it's kind of unlikely for you to have clashing commit hashes even across all Git repositories. So when you have a commit hash, it sort of uniquely identifies that commit in the world, right? Of course, the chance of collision increases with time, but so if you want to look at how a submodule is represented, how a submodule shows up in Git, right? You can see it shows up like that, right? It indicates it as a submodule, and then like you can click on it, and if the repository is on GitHub, then you can just click on it, and it'll bring you to that whatever repository it is at that particular at that particular commit. Yeah. So it's kind of convenient, right? So that is submodules. Okay. Let us now look at multiple work trees, right? So if you work on any large project, you are likely to have multiple branches in that project, right? And sometimes you want to, for whatever reason, you might want to have multiple branches checked out at the same time, right? That's why you can use the work tree feature for, right? So we can just, so you can just say git work tree. And you can see we have one work tree. Let's say I want to check out the branch that is called branch, right? At the same, as a separate work tree, so I can have both of the branches checked out at the same time. Right. So now if I go out, I am now on the branch, right? If I go back, I am on the master branch. So now I have both of the work trees checked out, and I can just work on them as per normal. So that is a convenient feature. Let's see. So now let's try to delete that that other worksheet. Okay, so you can see that there's only one, that worksheet has now been removed lah. So this is just a convenient feature for you to have multiple worksheets checked out in a Git repository, just in case you need to do things across multiple branches. Or, you know, for example, on GitHub, sometimes you have your main project branch and then a GitHub Pages branch, right? And you don't want to, you know, if you want to have both of them checked out at the same time, because let's say the GitHub Pages branch is entirely separate from the main branch, then, you know, might make sense to have both of them checked out at the same time, right? So you can do that with Git worktree. Okay, so that is the worktree feature. Okay, let's look at finally the Git directory. Okay, so what is in the Git directory, right? Let's go and see. So we can see here there are a number of things. Let's go through them one by one. I only included the most common things that you might want to see or look at inside here. But there are other things lah. So the branches directory is sort of a legacy way that Git users use to store branches. Nowadays, branches are all inside the refs folder. This is just the message that you edit in, like when you create a new commit. This is where your commit message is saved to lah. Then this config is any repository specific Git configuration. So like if you want to have a custom name and email for a particular repository, you can do that, right? This description is just a repository description, which I think no one actually uses. only if you use like Git web, which is like only if you use something like Git web, and then this is where the description is pulled from lah. It's pulled from this file in the .git directory. And so this was the directory. This directory contains the data that was used by filter repository. Then like we have this is some data for Git GUI. The built-in GUI in Git. So hit is the file that contains the active ref. So like if I cat hit, right, you can see that it points to refs hits master, which corresponds to my active branch. It points to the master branch. Hooks, Git hooks, something that I didn't talk about today. It's basically a way for you to run arbitrary shell scripts whenever you do certain actions. So like you can look into it more if you're interested. So like some people use this to automatically run, let's say, unit tests before you push, and then like cancel the push if the unit tests fail, things like that. I personally don't like it because like I personally run the test before I even try to push, so then when I push again it runs it for me, then it's kind of annoying. So I myself disable hooks. I disable hooks across all repositories. But you know, some people like them. What else is there? Yes, there's an index. So the index is what is the so-called staging area of Git. So the index is actually where all the commands work on. So like your commit command works on the index, right? And so on. The only commands that work on the index itself are like reset and add. So like you can add stuff to the index and reset stuff out of the index. That's what that's the index. And then there is the logs. So this is where all the ref logs are stored, right? So if you want to delete all the ref logs, you can just delete this directory and you'll be fine. In case you want to reduce the size of a repository or whatever. The modules here contains the information of it contains the git directories of the submodules, right? So they're included in the git directory in case you want to say switch between a commit. If you want to switch to a commit that doesn't contain the submodule, right? If then git has to remove the submodules directory. But so if if the git directory were then included, were to be included in the submodules working tree, right? Then if you switch away into a commit that doesn't have the submodule, right? Then the submodule's git directory will also be lost, right? So that is not ideal. That's why the git directories of submodules are included in the main git directory instead of within the submodules themselves. Yes, and then we have objects. So the objects directory contains all of the objects in our repository. Yeah. Finally, we have packed refs and refs. So what is packed refs? Basically, it's a list of refs, right? So these refs are actually just byproducts of the filter repo, right? These are the main refs. So we have abstract branch, bisect branch, and so on. And then if you look at if you then look at refs, right? These refs are actual files, right? So I can just cat, right? And they will point to a particular commit hash. This takes precedence, right? So if this doesn't exist, then Git will look into the packed refs. When you first clone a Git repository, all the refs are inside packed refs, and then as you use the refs, then Git will create the files representing them inside the refs directory lah. Yeah. So just to make it clear, what a head just points to this ref, and head indicates which is the active branch, and then this ref will indicate where the branch, which commit the branch actually is currently pointing to lah. So that is what is in the Git directory. So, okay, let's look at GC. Okay, let me again. Oops. Do I not have Origin Master anymore? Why do I not have Origin Master? I think the filter repo might have made me lose my Okay, no worries. Let me just clone it again. Where is my Okay, so I am now back onto the origin, the original master commit. So the exercise here is to add and commit a new file. So let us do that. All right, let's add it. Okay, And then now we can so let me just move ahead, skip ahead first. Right. Basically we need to be able to we need to have a way to tell that the file is still in the repository, right? So this cat file lets you print the contents of any object. So in this case, we can print this object and it's a commit, right? So we want to look at the tree, right? And this tree contains this file. So we want to look at new file, right? New file contains the contents, new file, right? That's it. Okay. So now we want to get rid of this object, right? So even if we reset, away to the parent commit, right? The object is obviously still within the Git repository, right? And if we look at reflog, of course the commit is still here, lah. So in order for us to remove the object from the repository, we need to first clear the reflog. So there are two ways to do it. One way is to use Git reflog. If you look at the reflog manual, yes, you can expire. You can expire reflog entries. So like So now, once you expire all the reflog entries, the reflog will be empty, right? And now we can do a git gc, right? And if we now try to print the object again, you can see that it is no longer in the Git repository, right? So this is how you purge an object from a Git repository, lah. You might have to lose your reflog, lor. No choice. Just note that, of course, even if you purge something from your local repository, if you have already pushed it to say GitHub, right, it's not, you can't just remove it like that, because the object will still linger around in GitHub's internal database, right? So if you accidentally push a secret file or something to GitHub, then you might have to, and you want to remove it, you have to contact GitHub support to help you remove it, lah. You cannot, it's not sufficient to just reset the commit away, because even if there is, the commit is not pointed to by any branch, it's possible for someone to, if they know the commit hash, they can still access it, lah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's the same for any because the way push works is push doesn't remove things from the remote. Push just pushes whatever, like basically how push works is it will look at what you're pushing, right, and it will determine, okay, what objects does the remote site need need to have to be able to what objects does a remote site not have, right? And then it will just push those It will send those objects over, lah. But if the remote site has extra objects, it's not going to remove those objects. So as long as if someone still has a particular hash of the object or the file, so like it could be a file or a commit, right? They can still access it through GitHub interface. You just said it, so like when you go to a particular commit, you can see here the commit URL is within the the commit hash is within the URL, right? And so if they know the commit hash, they can just access it. Of course I haven't pushed, so it's not going to work, but if I were to push, and even if I reset away the and then push and force push the branch so that the branch no longer points to the commit, the commit is now in GitHub's database. So you must if you really need to remove the object or commit from GitHub, then you need to contact support lah, and they will help you do it. This is a known issue, as in it's not issue, as in it's a known thing. So they do specify that if you accidentally commit secrets, then just contact support for them to help you clear it from their clear it lah. Okay, that is Git GC. So Git will run GC by itself automatically when it feels when it determines that the repository is getting large, right? So but if you feel like you want to conserve, if you have done something that might be, you know, messy, not say messy, but you might have, if you've done things or you have had this repository for a while and you want to clean it up, then you can just run Git GC lah. Okay, let's see. Yes. So this is the last thing that we are going to do, which is to make a commit by hand. And there is more information in the Git book, right? Actually, yeah, there is an entire section on Git internals. So if you're interested in more details about Git internals, you can read the book. But today we're just going to look at the how a commit is actually created, okay? Okay, so let me just yes. Okay. Let me just clone a copy because filter repo, it doesn't leave your repository in a very clean state. You can see this by the replace the, like basically it does some operations and the best way to use filter repo is on a clean copy lah. Yeah. Otherwise it can get a bit messy. Okay. So how do you actually create a new commit by hand, right? Or actually what is Git commit doing under the scenes, behind the scenes? So let us again create a new file. Okay. So the first thing we want to do is to add the new file to the index. So what we can do is to use git update index. Right. And then we're just going to specify the file. Right. And now if you actually look at git status, you can see that it has added the file. So, yes. Next thing you can do, right, is to do git write tree, right? So now if you were to look at our index is still at hasn't changed, right? And our commit hasn't changed. All we've done is taken this index and written it out to a tree. So we can look at this tree using git cat file, right? And you can see this tree has our new file here. And and if you look at our head, right, it has a different tree. So what's the difference between the tree? Of course, this is our current commit, doesn't have new file. This is our new tree, which has a new file, right? So once we have written a new tree, you can then git. And so git commit tree will then try to read the commit message from standard input. So let's say, right? And it has created a new commit. Yeah. But it has created a new commit, but it hasn't updated the ref, right? So last thing we want to do is, and you can see that, okay, we didn't specify a parent for the commit. Uh, So let us fix that. Yeah, let us specify a parent commit. Let us specify a parent commit for the file. Right. And let us set the ref to the commit with a parent, right? And of course we can see now it is correct. Git add just does update index. So this is git add, and then git commit does the rest. So it writes a tree, commits a tree, and then updates the ref. Right, that's what git commit does. Yeah. Okay. So that is it. That's all we are covering today. Apologies for starting late again today. I had a lot of issues starting my system. Please fill in the feedback form. There's only 8 people left, but thank you for staying.